Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear a story about art and baseball. Ana Mateo and Katie Weaver present the next part of our early literacy series. Finally, you will hear part one of the Learning English Route 66 Road Trip series. But first, Ian Happ is a professional baseball player for the Chicago Cubs of Major League Baseball in the United States. When he first started playing with the team in 2017, he was looking for pictures to hang in his home. From that simple desire came an idea and an unlikely partnership with a British artist. Happ wanted art that showed Wrigley Field, the Cubs ballpark, from a different viewpoint. Happ said that many fans have been to Wrigley, but have never seen what the ballpark looks like from the field. He thought looking up from the field was such a cool experience that he wanted to bring that to more Cubs fans. He hired the British artist Patrick Vale to create three large drawings of Wrigley from his point of view 5 years ago. Instead of having pictures to hang in his home, the partnership led to something quite different. Happ's view of Wrigley Field became the Through My Eyes project, in which fans can purchase prints. The money goes toward Happ's charity. The drawings by Vale became See What I See, an exhibit at Chicago's Gallery Victor. The show is open through August 26th. All this started with Happ simply looking for artwork. A college teammate at the University of Cincinnati had become an architect in New York. That teammate gave Happ the names of several artists. One was Vale. Happ noticed the level of detail in Vale's drawings of cities. After talking with Vale, Happ got the idea to bring Vale to Chicago and draw Wrigley Field from a viewpoint few fans get to experience. The drawings would be from a player's point of view, looking out onto the field and into the stands of the famous ballpark. Happ brought Vale to Chicago in September of 2018 and showed him around Wrigley. Vale knew little about the sport of baseball, but he understood the connection fans have with Wrigley. "I understand when people talk about baseball and their connections to family and family stories and childhood," said Vale, who lives in New York. "It's the same for me with cricket. I can remember summers in the garden with Grandpa and listening to the radio." Happ had to explain to Vale the importance of the 400-foot sign in center field and the famous manual scoreboard and ivy. He had to teach him the correct positioning of the players. Happ also explained what it feels like standing in the field under the bright lights with a loud crowd. Vale took pictures and used them to help him create drawings in great detail. He would send rough drawings to Happ, who would mark them up in red ink, like a teacher, with suggestions. The drawings are mostly in black and white. They show everything from the faces of the fans and the people selling drinks to the numbers and pictures on the video screen. They show a celebration from the view of someone looking down the left field line. And there is the view from the dugout looking toward third base and right field as the pitcher throws with the bright lights shining. He was talking about very specific moments, Vail said of Hap. The scoreboard needs to feel like the scoreboard, right? I had to respect it and the place. Next is the VOA Learning English Education Report. This week, we continue with our Early Literacy series with Anna Mateo and Katie Weaver. Anna is here now to talk about what you will hear in today's episode. Hi, Anna.
Hi, Ashley. It's good to be here.
Today's episode centers on vocabulary. What makes vocabulary such a key part of literacy?
Our vocabulary is all the words we use to speak, write, and read. We need a strong vocabulary to share ideas. So English teachers and English learners should focus heavily on building vocabulary.
What are some tips included in the story for vocabulary building?
There are several tips or suggestions in the story. When you learn a new word, use it often and in different ways. Say it, listen to it, write it. Use it in a sentence, and then say the sentence out loud.
Another one I noticed in your report is this. If you are reading a new text, learn the new vocabulary first.
That is a very easy strategy, but also a very effective one. Also, use visual aids as much as you can. Things like videos, drawings, charts, they can all help you remember a word.
What are some other ways students can remember new words?
Well, you can summarize. You can define a word in your own words. You can also role play with new words.
So a teacher could give students a text to read and have them act it out.
That's right. And more advanced students can write their own text, conversation, or even a play. They can read it with other learners, either in a classroom or outside the classroom.
Great. Thanks for those suggestions.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
Now, here is more from Anna and Katie.
The words we use to speak, write, and read are called our vocabulary. We need a strong vocabulary to share ideas. Teaching tips for vocabulary. An English teacher should focus heavily on building vocabulary. When you teach your students new words, use strategies and activities that allow them to draw, read, write, and repeat new words as much as possible.
Use examples suited to the age of your students. If you teach the word happy to younger students, your example might be, "My friend gave me a toy. I felt happy." But you probably would not use that example with an older student. In that case, an example might be, "My job makes me happy."
Create a sentence frame for the students to use. Sentence frames help students use a word quickly and in a complete thought. They are ready-made sentences. Sentence frames for the word happy could be, "I feel happy when blank. Blank makes me happy."
Use visual aids and appeal to all your students' senses. When you teach a new word, show a picture. If you teach the word bug, show or bring in a bug. If you teach the word happy, show them happiness. Have them act it out. Use the senses often.
Once you teach a new word, use it often. The more students use a new word, the more likely they are to learn and remember it.
Use vocabulary across subject matter. Include words you use in other classes, like math and science. Students are more likely to learn a word if they use it in different situations.
Finish the new word lesson with a question or quick activity. You could ask, "What do people look like when they are happy? Can you show me?" Then have each student show happiness. Strategies for vocabulary.
Strategy. First, teach important words and ideas. Before reading a story, your students should understand the words and ideas in the story. Make a vocabulary list of key words in the text. Post the list in the classroom. Say the words with students. Talk about the meanings. Also, explain any new ideas in the story.
Strategy: Active read aloud. This strategy can be used for vocabulary and comprehension. When reading aloud to your class, ask questions about a new or important word. Let students answer in their home language or English. Correct or add to the students' answers. Here is an example.
What does it mean to hate somebody?
You do not like them.
Yes, but a little or a lot?
A lot. You do not like them a lot. Explain the meaning of the word. Give a definition, related words, and examples. Use your face, objects, pictures, or physical movements to show word meanings while they read aloud.
Strategy: Word map. A word map is like a picture. It organizes information in a visual way. Word maps help students to think about new words in different ways. On the board or on paper, write the new word in the middle of the map. Tell the students to think about the word. Then they fill in the rest of the map with a definition, sentences using the word, related words, unrelated words, and pictures to explain the word. Do this as a whole class or in small groups.
Assessment for vocabulary. Assessing or testing vocabulary in your students is very important. Here are some ways to assess vocabulary of early and advanced learners. Match words with visuals. This type of assessment is very helpful for early learners and learners with a very low English level. Choose the target words, the words you want to test. Then collect or draw pictures to go with each word. You can also use objects. Say the word and then have the student choose the correct picture or object.
Interviews. Choose the target words and ask the student questions. Can you use this word in a sentence? What word in your language means the same thing? Use your face and body to show the word's meaning.
in their own words. Summarize. Give students a short text to read. Make sure the text has target vocabulary. Students then can show their understanding of the vocabulary by retelling, describing, or explaining the text. You can also ask students to talk about a character or favorite part of the story using the target vocabulary.
Role plays. Role plays are a form of acting. Give students a text to read and have them act it out. More advanced students can write a play using the target vocabulary. Students can play the role of the teacher and review vocabulary with the class.
Use these tips, strategies, and assessment methods that best serve you and your learners. Change them to fit your students and teaching situation. I'm Anna Mateo.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
In September of 2015, VOA Learning English traveled along the famous Route 66, the 3,900-kilometer-long highway stretches from Chicago, Illinois, to Los Angeles, California. For the next 2 weeks, you will hear our reports from the road. We tell you about the communities, the people, the food, and the special landmarks that make up the highway that's the best. These stories first aired in late 2015.
On November 11th, 1926, a 3,900-kilometer-long highway was established in the United States. It was not the first American highway. It was not the longest either. And it might not have been the fastest. But the road inspired musicians, writers, and filmmakers. It appealed to explorers and dreamers. It's known as Route 66. How did this road become a major symbol of freedom and adventure in America? Why does this road, now unofficial, continue to draw so many onto its well-worn path? VOA Learning English took the long drive from Illinois to California to find the answers to those questions. We will share what we learned when we motored west down the highway.
From Chicago to LA, as the song goes. Between Illinois and California, there is Missouri, a little Kansas, and a lot of Oklahoma. After a brief stretch in Texas come New Mexico, Arizona, and finally, California. The road cuts through cornfields, deserts, mountains, and unique red rock formations of the West.
As the scene outside the car window changes, so too do the people and cultures found along the road. Route 66 connects farm communities, small towns, and major urban centers. For the traveler, it opens up the worlds of cowboy culture, Native American life, Mexican traditions, and more.
The idea for Route 66 started in Oklahoma. Citizens there wanted to link their state with states to the east and west. U.S. federal officials also saw the benefit of connecting state roads to provide a more direct and faster way across the country. Oklahoma businessman Cyrus Avery is credited with developing the plan to connect existing state roads into one long national highway. He is known as the father of Route 66. It was disaster that fueled the road's early success. A series of powerful dust storms in the 1930s destroyed a huge amount of farmland across the prairie states. Hundreds of thousands of mostly poor farm workers and their families began to leave. The migrants headed west on Route 66, hoping the path would lead to a better life in California, the land of opportunity. American writer John Steinbeck immortalized the road in 1939 with his novel, The Grapes of Wrath. The book also gave Route 66 its most famous nickname, the Mother Road. Steinbeck wrote, 66 is the path of a people in flight, refugees from dust and shrinking land. 66 is the Mother Road, the road of flight.
Exploring the open road has long been an important part of the American experience, and Route 66 became even more popular as the car culture exploded in the 1940s and 50s. By the 1960s, large parts of Route 66 were not fit for driving. And by 1985, the road was officially decommissioned from the national highway system. The U.S. government built bigger highways with faster speed limits and fewer traffic lights. These new interstates bypassed small towns, the heart of Route 66. Many of these small towns had depended on Route 66 for business and income. The economies of bypassed small towns suffered. When the traffic stopped on Route 66, so did many of the towns themselves. Along the road today, rundown motel signs, abandoned service stations, and empty houses are signs of these forgotten towns. Jeannie Tate is from Lebanon, Missouri. She has lived her whole life right along Route 66. She remembers clearly what the road did for her small community.
Changed a lot. It changed a lot of lives for Lebanon because so many businesses, it made the industry, made it more attractive for industry. It made the city grow because people wanted to be here. But it's just, you know, it's one of the hot spots of Route 66.
Today, Jeannie Tate is concerned about an historic part of the road, the Hazel Green Bridge on the edge of town. The state of Missouri, she said, does not want to pay money for the repairs the bridge needs. It has been closed now for many months.
I would like to see them repair it and not tear it down and build a new one. We don't, you know, we need to hang on to what we have, even though, you know, it might not be as modern. But modern isn't always the best anyway.
While most American motorists may have forgotten Route 66, foreign tourists have not. International interest in the road is growing each year. People come from places as far as Brazil and Germany, Japan and China, to fulfill what they consider a lifelong dream. Ednilson Gablacki is from Brazil. We met him at the Santa Monica Pier the official end of Route 66. He and 15 other Brazilians had just finished traveling the Mother Road.
We just finished our dream trip. We start like 15 days ago. Well, it's a kind of a dream. We saw movies, we saw on the television, magazines, so photos. Today we can see the internet, so many videos. So I think everybody knows about something about Route 66, right?
Fran Huston has worked along the road for more than 20 years in Adrian, Texas. The town is considered the midpoint of the original Route 66. Fran owns the Sunflower Station gift shop along Route 66. She said the number of tourists traveling the Mother Road has been growing year by year.
It has grown bigger every single year. We are seeing this year tons of people from China, which we had not seen a few years ago. We see them from Japan, New Zealand, Italy, as our friends back there are from. It's all over the world, and it is wonderfully gratifying.
Interest among American tourists is growing as well, thanks in part to the 2006 movie Cars. Fran herself was represented in the film. She was the inspiration for the character Flo.
We are now, because of the movie Cars, seeing more and more Americans, all looking for Radiator Springs.
Brian Rodriguez works at a Route 66 information booth on the Santa Monica Pier. He recently took his first trip along part of the Mother Road.
I ended up finding out that Route 66 is very much alive. You know, it's just kind of like the movie Cars. He's just racing in the fast world, and then he finds out about 66, and it teaches him to slow down. And in L.A., unfortunately, that's how the world is in L.A. Everything's just so fast-paced, you forget to slow down and enjoy the everyday life.
For supporters of Route 66, its future is as important as its storied past. Small communities may have been bypassed by high-speed interstates, but the towns can still thrive. Galena, Kansas is an example of that. The small town went from a population of 1,500 in 2006 to a little over 3,000 today. Melba Riggs lives in Galena. She and her siblings opened the Cars on the Route Cafe in 2006. Melba knows people all up and down Route 66, both locals and fellow business owners. And people all along Route 66 know all about Melba, or Melba the Mouth, as she is known.
And they call me the Mouth because I do have a tendency to talk a little bit faster than me.
Her fast-talking ways earned her the nickname. The people along Route 66 share a connection. Whether they live in California or Texas, Missouri or Kansas, they support each other. They want Route 66 to thrive. Melba the Mouth sums up their common bond with these 7 words. Friends don't let friends take the interstate. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver. Join us next week for a special report on Chicago, Illinois, where Route 66 begins its journey west.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.